because I've always respected this process and the law, I have been quiet until now. Well, that day is over. After reviewing the commission's findings of fact, they have relied on speculation and innuendo that are not based on evidence, which is required by law, and in many instances, refuted by the clear and uncontested testimony in the record, some of which they omitted in their final findings of fact. Nothing about yesterday should surprise anyone. The fix was in from day one, overseen by this Greg Fisher hand-picked, selected commission. You may say, well, Tony, there are two registered Republicans on this commission. But the fact is, and this is a tactic Greg Fisher used in other commissions as well, that the two Republican members were Democrats until shortly before they were appointed to the commission. I think it is fair to ask, and I have the proof here in an open records request to the county attorney's office, I have their registrations showing them changing from Democrat to Republican within a short period of time before they were appointed. I think it's fair to ask if the commission is actually reflective of the political diversity within our community, or if it was just set up to appear that way. But then you may ask, what about their actions? Well, I also took a look at their CREF filings. Other than two donations of the two supposedly Republican members of the commission, all of their political donations are to Democrats. By all appearances, this was political diversity in name only. Now, I want to be clear in making these statements that I do not mean to suggest that Republicans and Democrats are expected to vote lockstep in a way that advances a partisan interest, either on this commission or otherwise. But I do think it is important to question whether this commission has truly achieved the goal of ideological diversity, or if that is just an illusion. These are requirements in law, along with gender, race, and geography. Greg Fisher regularly flaunted them, and he successfully stacked this commission with his own political ideologues. I didn't bother printing the other members' political donations because they are 100% to Democrats, well over $10,000 worth. This is a Greg Fisher handpicked commission, and frankly, the fix was in since day one. For example, let's examine the commission chair, Deeg Pregliasco's op-ed, published immediately after my hearing, directed to local Republican legislators when she said they, and I'm directly quoting here, quote, don't like diversity, equity, marginalized students, non-English speaking immigrants, and poor people, end quote. The chair of this commission attacking Republican legislators, calling them bigots that hate poor people. In what universe is it responsible that the chairperson of an administrative hearing overseeing the fate of the local Republican legislator writes an op-ed making inflammatory and ad hominem attacks against Republican legislators in the middle of the deliberations? Beyond that, there are a range of other procedural abnormalities. For example, the commission appears to have improperly assigned counsel to the complainant at taxpayer expense, and allowed his attorney to be the prosecutor, a person with a clear bias who is representing the complainant, instead of an independent representative of the commission who was interested in justice. At the same time, the commission's appointed prosecutor did virtually nothing at the hearing, asked one question in 4 days, except to make an inflammatory statement at the end of the trial that made a blatant appeal to his relationship with the commission, who was acting as the jury. While my attorney stuck to the facts and the law, they appealed to speculation and personal appeals to the people deciding my fate. Again, the fix was in from day one. Another example was our repeated attempts to get records under the Open Records Act. I made 4 open records requests, and the Attorney General determined that either the commission or Metro government or both violated the Open Records Act each time. Every single time I made the requests, they broke the law. Each of them affected my ability to defend myself. The most egregious case is one of the first open records requests I did, having to do with the public disclosure of my response to the ethics complaint. The commission delayed and delayed in the lead up to my case in front of the circuit court. Despite promises to release the record sooner, the commission waited until after the court case was over to release responsive documents, including an email that I have right here from its attorney that backed up our position that the disclosure of our response was improper and directly contradicted the position they took in court. I'm going to read to you directly from this email. This is from Todd Lewis, the lawyer for the commission, copying Dee Pregliasco, the chair of the commission, sending the email to members of the Greenberg administration who are administering the Open Records Act, where he says, Todd Lewis says, quote, "The most important thing right now is that we believe all," and he fully capitalizes the word all, "documents connected to the currently pending investigation are exempt under KRS 61.878H, I, and J at this time. This is important because one of the participants to that process is objecting to the disclosure. And improper disclosure will harm our ability to carry out this case. Not shall, not could, will harm their ability." And yet he walked into court and said the exact opposite in his position while knowing that this email existed. That court rendered its decision on the 12th. The Attorney General rendered their decision calling this action illegal on the 13th. We received this email so conveniently on the 14th, after the 2 days after the judge finished their opinion. This seems like a willful violation of the Open Records Act. And again, the fix was in from day one. I could go on. There were irregularities in the investigative process, witnesses with clear political bias and no personal knowledge were interviewed and allowed to provide information, quote, off the record, unquote, so that we didn't know what they told the investigator until the trial. This is only a sample of the procedural problems in this case. Further, I will continue to reiterate that this case completely lacks evidence required by law. When I was first approached about a job or anything of value, I did precisely what the law required and what council people for 20 years have done in this Metro Council. I removed myself from the process, I ceased speaking to anyone about the ordinance, and I abstained from the vote at the next public meeting in accordance with the law. I did not violate the law. I never used my office for personal gain, never. I'm not a perfect man, but I would rather die then accept what they have accused me of. I will use every legal means in my power to fight this, to bring truth and facts to light, and continue serving the people of District 19. I have just begun to fight. With that, I'll take a few questions. I have my attorney, Brooke and Smith, here from the firm of Swansburg and Smith as well. Yeah, we talked about this in trial. We called it the coincidence of timing. And I have no dispute that, you know, I can't control when somebody approaches me about a job, right? I have no control over that. When they do, I am then required to do what the law requires me to do. And I did precisely that, right? In their findings of fact, I would come back to what we've said here. They either omitted facts that disputed things they said, or even those comments have requirements in the law that frankly they did not achieve. So they made huge logical jumps and inferences and then omitted things that refuted things they had in their findings of fact. Do you want to add anything there?
Can you give examples of what they omitted?
We're going to talk about that through our legal process, right?
What legally can you do now? Are you looking to go to the courts? What's happening?
Do you want to talk through the legal?
Sure. There's a number of avenues, including seeking judicial review of the commission's findings of fact and conclusions of law. That's certainly one avenue that we're taking a very close look at.
Any other questions?
Would you say there are one or two things that when this goes to court, you'll be able to point to as proof that the Ethics Commission erred in its findings?
It'll be far more than one or two.
What's your response to the Ethics Commission's stance since you heard public trust?
What I said during the hearing, and I will stick by this, is that if there was anything that I look back with, and again, I said in the hearing, if I could get in a time machine and go back in time, I would have communicated differently, okay? That is a part of the process. And I think, and David James even said this when he was interviewed, that the style, had it been different, he said, quote, we wouldn't even be here, right? If there's something to be learned by the process or by the words that were used, I'm fine with that, right? But that is a far leap from what I'm being accused of here, right? So again, I was more than willing at any time during this process to be more upfront with the public, but the legal process, you know, again, I respected it and didn't want to be accused or practically to tamper with the process that I respected. But clearly, I would argue, the Ethics Commission didn't have the same respect for this process that I have.
Do you regret not shedding light on your relationship with the organization before all this?
Like I said,
going back in a time machine.
Yeah, going back, what I said was going back in a time machine, if I could have communicated that differently at the time and avoided all of this confusion. I don't dispute that, and this is why I've got the evidence binders with me. I'm going to have them as I walk around and talk about this. I want all the evidence out in the open. I'll call on the Ethics Commission to release all of the evidence to the public as quickly as possible, because the evidence speaks for itself, right? The evidence is very clear. I can't help people's perceptions. There are people that don't like me and wanted me out of office before any of this ever happened, right? Because they perceive that I am a bad person, right? This is why evidence and facts and the law are critical, so that we aren't removing people because we don't like them, we don't agree with what they think, right? I was elected by thousands of people to represent my district. I have worked incredibly hard to do that, all members of my district, and that's what I'm gonna continue to do while I'm on council. Maybe one more question.
Mayor Greenberg is having a press conference at noon. We don't know, all we know about it is that it's gonna deal with ARPA funding. Are you concerned that the CEOC might have to give back the $40 million?
You should speak to the CEOC about that. I'm focused on the ethics case here, and I look forward to hearing what Mayor Greenberg has to say at noon. Yes.
In your research, have you uncovered any other Ethics Commission findings with which you disagree or which could set precedent for the decision that was made about the particular case?
Well, funny thing is, one of the open records requests I made was from all the documentation from some of the prior cases they've done. And they came, two of the prior cases that ended up going in front of council, and in both cases they said they had no documentation or they just had a cover page. So part of this is their complete failure to manage their own records, which makes it extremely difficult, frankly, to make those sort of comparison judgments. And that's precisely what we were trying to do, or it's one of the aspects that we were trying to do. So no, it's hard to do it because, frankly, they don't have or they failed to produce to us the documents that were relevant to our request.
All of open records, you've experienced the open records backlog now.
Mm-hmm.
Things that we've all been doing for years.
Oh, well, let me put it this way. I was on Mayor Greenberg's transition team. I was honored to be there. I think it spoke well of his desire to have different opinions at the table. I sat in a meeting. It was Deputy Mayor David James was there, Deputy Mayor Dana Maton was there, I believe Chief of Staff David Kaplan was there, and I said to them in no uncertain terms that the open records problems that the Fisher administration created should have been not only their priority number one, but I encouraged them to immediately appoint somebody during the transition process to meet with that department and fix it immediately. I completely have sympathized, this is not new for me, what the media and the public have been going through related to that process. I encourage them to fix it at that time, and clearly it continues to be a complete disaster.
Thank you. he would ask the commission to find that you violated those accusations against you. Did you look into his records like you did the voting members to see if he had changed his mind?
Yes, sorry, to be more specific, and I'm sorry I wasn't more specific about that. There are only two members that are listed as Republicans on the Ethics Commission, Robert Boyd and Michael Euler. Robert Boyd was the one that was the appointed investigating officer. He was supposed to be the actual prosecutor throughout the process. Again, he made a bland opening statement, asked one question in 4 days, and made a closing statement, as I indicated earlier, that was wholly inappropriate. He actually appealed to his personal relationship with the people standing in judgment of me, completely failed to talk about any, just made declaratory statements to my guilt, and said that, but lacked any evidence in his statement. But he was one of the two. Those were the two people that were, let's call it, recent converts to the Republican Party, but their actions related to their donor records, I think, speak to the fact that ideologically, that's not true at all. Thank you very much. I'm sorry? So I would say that I've not seen any of the details of that. What I would say is, given there's been an ethics complaint filed against him, and I'm taking your word for that, I've not seen the documentation, let's put it this way, the Ethics Commission had better treat him in precisely the same way they treated me, or it will expose this for exactly what it is, and that's a partisan hit job. Thank you very much, everybody. Appreciate it.